Good evening. Thank you all so much for being here tonight, and thank you very much for the introduction. It's kind of funny for me tonight because there are some of you in the room that I know quite well, and then others I don't know at all. So forgive me for those who have heard part of this before, but I was asked to start at the beginning, so that's what I'm going to do. So let me do that. Let me start by just giving you a little bit of background about who I am and what brings me to stand in front of you today. There are kind of two pictures that stay with me in absolutely everything that I do. And the first is a picture of a little girl, and she's 6 years old. And in my mind, she's holding the hand of a little boy who is 4 years old. And they're getting ready to board a ship. The ship is bound for a country that neither of them have ever been to before, that speaks a language that neither of them speak. And only one of them can find the country on the map because the other one has not yet even begun school. They've learned only 24 hours before that they will be traveling together. And on this trip, they will travel with neither their mother nor their father, but are traveling only with a woman whose last name they know and whose first name they will never know. The year is 1939. The little girl in the picture is my mom. The little boy is her brother. And a woman, a family friend who cared enough, took them across the ocean to the United States in an effort to ensure their lives because they were from Vienna and they were Jews. And so in an effort to flee the Nazis, this one woman whom they never saw again brought them to this country where they were raised in an orphanage on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. But that story, which I was told from the moment I was old enough to hear it, is the story of how one woman, one person, can make a difference to the entire world, and at least to my world, because I stand here because of her. But there is a second picture in my life, and it's also a ship. It's called the SS St. Louis. It's often called the Voyage of the Damned. It's a ship that my grandfather boarded. It was bound for Cuba. He got on board with close to 1,100 other passengers who were also fleeing the Nazis. In my grandfather's case, as was the case with most of them, they sold everything they owned to buy passage on that ship. My grandfather planned to go to Cuba and send for his children in the United States and start life again. But when the boat got to Cuba, they learned that all of the documents they had purchased with their last pennies and nickels and dimes were fraudulent, and so Cuba would not let them in. And the boat sat in a harbor for 40 days while the world debated what to do with its passengers, and even the United States did not allow the passengers in. They were sent back to Europe, where the vast majority did perish at the hands of the Nazis. But my grandfather lived. And I had the privilege to know him. He lived to be 84 years old, so we spent a good number of years together. And he taught me what happens when the world turns its back and when no one gives a damn. And so I was raised in a house where that was put before you from the moment you were old enough. You could be the woman who saved my mom's life, or you could be the world that turns it back on my grandfather. So it's kind of not surprising that my siblings and I ended up in the professions we ended up in, and that I have the privilege now to serve as the CEO of the U.S. Fund for UNICEF. But when I first came to UNICEF, this is what I knew about UNICEF. I had worked in the nonprofit world for almost 30 years at that point, and all I knew was trick-or-treat for UNICEF. How many of you have ever trick-or-treated for UNICEF? Okay, statistically that's about right. Research tells me that 1 in 10 Americans has at some point in their life trick-or-treated for UNICEF. But that's all I knew. I had no idea of what UNICEF was really about. So they gave me a lot of things to read. I learned that we are 60 plus years of leadership for children, that while we started out as the United Nations International Children's Emergency Fund, the E being emergency, we have since become the United Nations International Children's Fund, dropping the E, but leaving it there because you all know us as UNICEF, meaning that we work in 190 countries and territories. most known because we're there yesterday, today, tomorrow. We don't just swoop in when there is an emergency. And that we're best known because we have resolve. We will stay till the job is done. Innovation, although we are over 60 years old, we're not afraid to try new things. But at the end of the day, for me, all of that information kind of went in one ear, out the other, and I was trying to get my arms around who is this organization I've come to work for. And so my then boss, because I came to UNICEF as number two, that's a whole story unto itself that I won't tell tonight, but my then boss took me to Africa in an attempt to explain to me what UNICEF was. And that first trip was to Mozambique in 2007. We got to Mozambique, and I spent the first 2 days traveling around with a mobile medical unit. So what that means is you're in a Jeep, you're off-road most of the time. There aren't a whole lot of roads in Mozambique to begin with once you get out of Maputo. So you're off-road, you're driving through the bush, you hope your driver knows where he's going. He speaks a language you don't speak, but you drive past a lot of trees, and suddenly he sees a tree that for whatever reason he recognizes, and he makes a left, and you come into a clearing, and there in the clearing could be a couple hundred people seated and waiting for the doctor. One doctor for every 50,000 people in the country of Mozambique, and the doctor comes once a month. And I sat there in that first day and I thought, I know how angry I get as a working mom when my kids were sick. If I couldn't see the pediatrician, never mind on a different day, at 8:01, which was the moment in my schedule that worked in the morning, then I was irate that wasn't that doctor there to serve me. And yet these moms, no matter how sick their child might be, will wait sometimes all the way 30 days to see a doctor. And so I began to get an understanding of what UNICEF was, but it was hit home to me when I went to a maternity clinic, which is the picture in the far end, but met this woman in the middle picture. Her name is Rosa. And what you can't see, it's hard to see, but right here, there is a little baby next to Rosa. She had given birth about an hour before I got there. The whole clinic, as you can see, had about 8 beds with bed nets on it in a room that went to kind of the end of this window from the screen. And Rosa pointed out to me, actually, how proud she was that there were actually screens in the window. She had never seen window screens before. And I walked over to her and I asked that question that it's not unusual to ask a new mom. I said, "Is this your first child?" And she answered me so matter-of-factly that at first I thought I had misheard her, because she said, "Well, it's the first one that lived." And this was my real introduction to UNICEF. I thought about when I gave birth to my first child. The day I found out I was pregnant, come on in, sit down. The day I found out I was pregnant, my mom bought me a little Gucci overnight bag. It was the only time in my life I've owned a Gucci overnight bag. And I was the first one of my generation to have a child. Everybody was very excited. I packed that suitcase the day my mom bought it for me. I had about another 8 months to go till I would give birth. But I packed it with this beautiful ethereal nightgown that I truly naively believed I would wear for that magic moment when I gave birth. And I put a bottle of champagne in there. And at that time it was pre-cell phone, so I had like that stack of note cards with people's numbers with a rubber band around it. So that went into the suitcase. And the book I would read while there, and I had a little Walkman that I was going to listen to music. I had this all planned. Rosa was working in a rice paddy when she went into labor. It was 106 degrees. She put down her bowl and she started to walk to the clinic. Nobody could go with her because no one else could afford to put their bowl down. And she walked for 4 hours in 106 degrees while in labor to get to that clinic. She sat outside on the lawn. When she was really ready to deliver, she came into the clinic and gave birth in a semi-sterile environment with a healthcare worker with a 6th grade education. When I gave birth to my first child, after 28 hours of labor, they did a C-section. That was not an option for Rosa. When I gave birth to my second child, I actually hemorrhaged and had all of the finest that New York had to offer, and I was saved. My child was saved. In Rose's case, had the baby even been breech, child and mom would have died because there was no one there who would have known even how to turn that child. And I sat in that room and I thought, at the time I was 50 years old, how did I get to be 50 years old and not know that the majority of women in the world give birth in environments like this, not environments like mine? And that was my introduction to what UNICEF was all about. UNICEF's mission is not just, though, to ensure that a child survives. It is to ensure that a child thrives, that we give and ensure that a child gets a life, but then that it's a life worth living. And Tony Lake, when he took over UNICEF several years ago, did some really interesting research looking at the economics of what we did and looking at the equity of what we did. And he created what's called the equity and human rights approach, because he, and this is his quote, that wherever the poorest children are, wherever the most vulnerable children are, whenever the forgotten children are, that is where we must be also, in even greater measure. And he inverted the paradigm of how this work was traditionally done. Traditionally, groups that are supporting children have looked at the most highly densely populated areas and gone in thinking we can have the biggest bang for our buck. But what he has proven in all of the research that's been done since is that the most effective measures in the fight to save children's lives are often the least expensive and greatest impact. Washing hands, teaching children to wash their hands, has saved more lives than almost any other initiative except immunization in the history of people. And so if you can go to a remote village and teach people to wash hands, you will save more lives than if you spend a great deal of money in a highly densely packed environment. And he changed what we're doing. And he challenged us to take that approach in our own countries, to look at the equity issues in our own countries, which we're doing. We have a fellows program here in the United States that's raising awareness about human rights. We have a huge end trafficking project that looks at the fact that while conditions in many countries lead to the possibility of a child being forced into trafficking or forced into prostitution, that we in this country sit in the largest marketplace for those children who are being bought and sold, and that we could have an impact on that issue if we could kill the marketplace, not just protect them in their countries. We are out there trying to win hearts and minds. Today, there are 65,000 volunteers in the US actively working with us, 300 high school clubs, some of whom are with us tonight, and 125 campus initiatives with over 2,500 active members on over 871 campuses, including Stanford. So it's really a huge hearts and minds campaign, not just a dollars campaign. But I talked about what we are at the core. This year has been an amazingly difficult year for UNICEF. The United Nations classifies crises, emergencies. There's a level one, which is a potential famine. A level two is a potential famine and a potential drought. But a level three emergency is an act immediately emergency. That's the Haiti earthquake, that's the tsunami, that's the hurricane, the storm Haiyan in the Philippines. That's a level three emergency. That's an all hands on deck. Every effort must be made. And yet we don't budget or plan for the emergency because we can't afford to say to that mom in Mozambique or anywhere else, sorry we didn't save your child, we're saving money in case there's an emergency. Sorry we didn't have enough staff to feed your child, we're saving staff in case there's an emergency. So when a level three happens, we go through a redeploy and an emergency campaign, and it has to be not instead of, but in addition to everything else we do. And in my career, in the 8 years now that I've led this organization, at any given moment there's been a level three emergency. And on two occasions, a level two emergency. At the moment, there are 5 level 3 emergencies. It's the first time in the history of the UN that there are 5 simultaneous emergencies. They are Central African Republic, South Sudan, Syria, Iraq, and Gaza. 5 level 5 emergencies. And one that I will share with you shortly that is about to be named the 6th. There's been a surge in violent conflict. There are millions of innocent children who are just under siege at the moment. In the Central African Republic alone, children have not attended school for 2 years because of the fighting. Think of the generation that is being lost. If we make it through this conflict, if they survive the conflict, what will they be left with? 2.3 million children in the Central African Republic. In South Sudan, the conflict has completely exacerbated the nutrition crisis there. And famine is, for the most part, imminent. We're days away from famine in South Sudan, with 3.75 million children affected by this crisis. Polio has returned to Syria, a disease we were confident we were winning the battle against, that we were eradicating polio. Has returned to Syria. 6.88 million children affected in Syria by the crisis. And nearby in Iraq, dozens upon dozens of children dying of dehydration in the year 2014, dying because they don't have water, something that we take so for granted in this country. 600,000 children affected in Iraq. And in Gaza, hundreds of thousands of children without an adequate water supply, 990,000 children currently impacted by the crisis in the Middle East. But the one that I haven't talked about, the one that I've spent, those who've been traveling with me, I think every minute on the phone between presentations this week, is the Ebola crisis. The current total number of probable, confirmed, suspected, you pick the adjective, cases in the current outbreak of the Ebola virus is 7,157 total cases, of which 3,330 have died. 7,157 cases, 3,330 dead. We were talking before outside, this is a country, these are countries that had so little to begin with. And suddenly that so little is being asked to conquer one of the largest plagues that we've seen in our history. And if we don't act now, we will not stay this crisis. Because the crisis is not only killing people and leaving children with no support, orphans in the wake, but the crisis is destroying everything we built till now. Food prices have soared because people can't go to work because there's all kinds of quarantines. So now what little precious resources there were are becoming even harder to obtain. Water sources are being cut off. Orphaned children, 3,700 at present. So there is this secondary wave of preventable child deaths due to the loss of routine health care. That doctor who might have caught malnutrition is now fighting Ebola. And the doctor who might have noted that the child had just come down with measles while there was time to cure the disease is now fighting Ebola. And so that there will be children whose lives could have been saved if we'd done nothing else, only based on what we had done to date. But the Ebola crisis is going to prevent them from getting anywhere near the resources that they need. And as always, the E comes back to UNICEF. And we are there delivering supplies, helping families. We are really the backbone to a door-to-door campaign that is educating communities, is getting people to be tested and checked. We are bringing in supplies. We just recently, working with Paul Allen's foundation and with others, made it possible for health kits to get in. And we will continue to be there. But we will need to do that in addition to everything else that UNICEF is doing. This picture appeared in the New York Times a couple days ago, last week, above the fold on the front page. I wrote Arthur Sulzberger and I thanked him for putting it there. It is a horrific picture to look at. And it is a little girl who is lying on the floor of a hospital called the McKinney Hospital in Sierra Leone. I know the McKinney Hospital. I have done work in the McKinney Hospital. And I know it because I was there on a tetanus campaign many years ago. We went there because there was a baby that had tetanus. And I had never seen the disease. And you know, in the United States, step on a nail, get a tetanus shot. Most of us required to have tetanus shots to go to school. If by some slip-up you actually contracted tetanus, $3.70 later, you've got a medication that will cure it. Not true in many countries around the globe. And we have a commitment to eliminating tetanus. You can't eradicate it, but you can eliminate it. And we went there to this hospital to see this child who was wreathing in agony. And as I looked around the hospital, no running water, no kitchen, mom sleeping next to the children on the floor, taking care of them, filthy conditions, not even a Tylenol for pain. I sat and I wept in that hospital because I watched a baby die for want of a $3.70 vaccine or medication. And I held the hand of her mom. It was the first time I'd ever seen a child die. And I watched the color drain out of that kid's hands. And I had to look that mother in the eye because I knew her child was gone, and she didn't yet know her child was gone. I walked out of the room to get a nurse. The nurse went in, and I will tell you, I can still hear this guttural wail that came out of that mom when she learned her child had died, 6 days old. What made it worse was the baby was born at home, as most are. The mom had just cut the umbilical cord with a piece of metal that was in her hut, and that is how the child contracted tetanus. If the mom had been immunized, she will pass that immunity on to her child for the first 3 months of the child's life. So the UNICEF campaign is actually geared towards moms. We are trying to immunize every woman of childbearing age to make sure that no child dies of a preventable cause. And I came back from that trip and I said, it's time we get loud. It's time we get proud. It's time that we scream from the highest mountaintop that we can that no child should die of a preventable cause. And it is what led to the slogan that has become popular with the US Fund called I Believe in Zero, because any number less than that is unacceptable. As I'll show you in the next slide, 17,000 children died today, all under the age of 5, all from causes we already know how to prevent. So these are not the children that die from an earthquake, a tsunami, a disease for which there's no cure, or the rocket that fell from the sky on them. These are children who are dying from things like tetanus or measles or lack of food or lack of water, and that is unacceptable. And as I said, you hold the hand of a mom who has just lost a child for want of $3.70, and you learn really quickly, that any number more than zero is completely unacceptable. So I wrote a book. Don't wait for the movie, please buy the book. And I do want Glenn Close to play me, so if you have the opportunity to write that into somebody, I'd really appreciate it. But I wrote the book because I really wanted America to hear that 17,000 children were dying every day. When I first came to UNICEF, that number was much higher. At one time, it was over 35,000 children dying every day. That was in the 1980s. We've halved that number. And we've halved it in a period during which the world's population has tripled. Think of a product. If I had a product that could show that kind of a success rate, I'd be a wealthy enough woman to fund this effort. And yet there is a perception in this country that we're fighting a battle we can't win. And I am really here to tell you we can win. Not only can we win, we have to win. And it is not acceptable to go about our lives and pretend we don't know it. So I wrote a book. And there's lots of stories in the book, and it is the stories of children. It's the stories of my fear of bugs. It's the stories of sleeping in a tent and being afraid and realizing that, you know, my fears were nothing compared to the fears of kids. But it's also the story of the tenacity of children, of their ability to be kids no matter where they are, that they play with a ball, that they sing songs that Ring Around La Rosie translates to every language, or Head, Shoulders, Knees, and Toes, and that they giggle even in the midst of what I consider abject hell, and that they make me laugh. And it is a remarkable privilege to get to experience that every day. So I'm going to end my formal comments with two short stories, one from the book and then one that has happened since I wrote the book. This particular story happened in Kenya. There was a very severe famine and in the areas surrounding Kenya. And we were trying very hard to get people to pay attention and help raise the money to feed children. And I couldn't get America to listen. And so I finally got a New York Times reporter to agree to do a story. The reporter interviewed me for close to 4 hours. And it's somewhere in the middle I got frustrated and I said, kind of loudly, I guess, but, you know, what mountain do I have to stand on? And how loud do I have to yell to get America on her feet? So after 4 hours, she did write her article. I got one quote in the entire article, and it was, what mountain do I have to stand on? How loud do I have to yell? And about a week later, I got this phone call, and my assistant came in and said, Buckingham Palace is on the phone, and I was, yeah, right, that's my friend Mark. He usually says he's Bruce Springsteen. And they said, no, it really is. It's Buckingham Palace, and I really didn't believe it, and I picked up the phone, but it was. And the then prince and princess agreed that they would answer that question and help us draw attention to what was going on. And they agreed that if we would come over to our warehouse in Copenhagen, they would come to the press corps, and they would help us pack a plane full of supplies, and they would draw the world's attention to it. So I went over to England. To Copenhagen. We flew for, like, you know, as long as that took, so 8 or 9 hours. And we went over to the warehouse, and we met the prince and princess. And I will tell you, everything they say about them is true. He is unbelievably handsome, only topped by how gorgeous she is. You love taking pictures next to her after you've been on a plane for 8 hours. And they were charming, and they were warm, and they were extremely sincere in their efforts. And British Air donated a plane. And UPS donated a plane, and we packed and stacked all day supplies into the trucks and then into the plane. And I got the privilege to fly on that 747 along with Cynthia McFadden, from who was then with Nightline Television, and a cameraman and my board chair. And we flew this plane along with the crew into Kenya. And it was pretty remarkable. It was a 747. You have no idea how big a 747 is till there are five of you flying on it with a crew, that we each had our own flight personnel person, and because they're required by law to have the same number flight personnel, whether they're five of us or 500 of us. And, you know, we made them give us a big bottle of wine. We had a lot of fun on the plane. So we'd been up now over 24 hours, and we had this long flight into Kenya. We landed in Kenya, in Nairobi, and we unloaded, drove around in little forklifts, got everything into little planes, and then Cynthia and her cameraman and I and Peter flew in a little 10-seater plane up to Kakuma to deliver these supplies. And we're driving, and we're all, like, kind of slap happy at this point because, you know, we've been up so many hours. And all of a sudden, the crew says to me, well, we need B-roll of the desert. You know, we need to see what the desert... We need to have footage of the desert for this Nightline show. So we pull over, and we haven't seen anybody for hours. I mean, we've been driving for a really long time, and here's what happened. We pulled off the road. We scrambled out of the cars. The news team busied themselves, deciding which angle they'd shoot from. Peter, who's my board chair, was talking with our UNICEF friends, and I stood by myself feeling a little woozy from the heat. I thought about going back to the car, but the windows were shut and the air was off, and I knew that that would be even worse. I stared at an empty expanse of the desert, nothing but rocks and sand, small hills, larger mountains in the distance. There was very little noise except our conversation. I'm not really sure what made me turn around, but as I did, I saw an emaciated woman come over the crest of a hill, holding the hand of a child. Maybe it was an hallucination caused by the heat, but I experienced her appearance in slow motion. At first, only seeing her head rising slowly above the sand line, then her body, and then the child's as she climbed higher and higher. I could not imagine where she had come from. It had been so long since we had passed anyone or anything remotely inhabitable. I cupped my hand over my forehead to get a better look. I couldn't decide how old or young the woman was. Her leathery, line-filled skin indicated a lifetime spent under the desert sun. She was very thin. The bones of her arms jutted out from the wrap she tied across her top, with the bottom wrap barely able to stay on her gaunt body. Her cheeks were gaunt, her eyes were hollow. The child, whose hand she now held very tightly, seemed equally ageless. Based on her height and weight, the child seemed quite young. But when I looked closer, I saw the telltale signs of stunting, a body that just didn't match the maturity of the face. Who were they? Why were they wandering the desert? Was the woman the mother of the child? The grandmother of the child? Where were they going? "Hello," I said, fully aware that they likely did not speak English. I took a cautious step closer, holding out my hand to her. The woman seemed stunned at my presence. She stepped backward and her eyes narrowed, letting me know that she would defend herself if necessary. I thought she might turn and run the other way, but she didn't. She seemed to assess me without moving, just staring into my eyes, trying to determine whether it was safe for her to approach. And we stood like that for some time, staring deeply at one another, silently testing one another, she on the top of the hill and I on the bottom. Everyone else so busy they hadn't even noticed her. The child hid behind her skirt, peeking out to the side. Somehow the moment passed. My fears evaporated, as did whatever fierceness I originally perceived in her. We were now connected in some sense, two women who happened to stumble upon one another in the desert. She knew no more about me than I knew about her. Certainly, she couldn't have known I was there as part of a relief effort. Still, her agenda was apparent. Keeping her eyes on me, she took her free hand and she rubbed her belly. Then she extended her hand to me like a cup waiting to be filled. She was hungry. She needed help. No matter how frightening my presence may have been, this basic need superseded any fears. The question had been posed, would I help? During dinner on the plane, I had placed an apple in my backpack. Now I grabbed it and I tossed it to her, and she caught it and she stared at it. Her eyes flicked back to meet my gaze. She held that stare for what felt like minutes, although in truth it may only have been seconds. She bowed her head in gratitude, a gesture that left me embarrassed. This piece of fruit that meant so much to her had meant so little to me. She turned and walked the other way. I read you that excerpt from the book because I really believe we each have an apple in our backpack. I believe that every one of us has something to give, and it doesn't have to be something that matters all that much to you, but it may be what someone else needs. For some, they have wealth to write the check that will make the difference. $1 buys enough water for a child for 40 days. For others, it's standing up when a hateful comment is made. For a third group, maybe you're a poet and you'll write about it, an artist and you'll paint about it, a teacher and you'll teach about it. But each of us can do something, take one action, dig into our backpack and find that something that we can do that could make the difference in a child's life. I've told that story all over the country since the book came out a year ago. I was very privileged and pleased that the book sold out in hardcover, thus the paperback. But a few months ago, I had the ultimate apple experience. I went to the refugee camp in Jordan for Syrian refugees, the Zatari camp. And we spent a day from sunup to sundown in schools, in clinics, everything in the camp. Hundreds of thousands of people pouring into this camp. Very difficult conditions, very little food, very little power or water. And this little boy who you see here followed me all day long. Wouldn't talk to me, wouldn't let us hold his hand, but everywhere we went, he went. And somewhere around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we realized this child had not eaten all day because we hadn't eaten all day. So we knew he had not eaten anything all day. And walking behind him was a girl that we had assumed was his sister all day. She looked about as if she was maybe 11 or 12. And she was carrying a baby on her hip, which we assumed was a third sibling. And they, too, had not eaten all day. It was winter. There was snow. This is how these children were dressed. Most of the kids in the camp walking barefoot in the snow. And so at one point, we had gone to a tent for breastfeeding women where they were giving them biscuits, nutritious biscuits, so that those that were lactating could get their nutrition levels up. And in all honesty, I don't eat carbohydrates. I'm trying to lose weight, so I hadn't eaten my biscuit. And so we decided to give this biscuit to this child who we knew hadn't eaten that day, and we really didn't know when he had last eaten. And I was with the actress Taya Leone, who is, in my mind, one of my real heroes. She's a phenomenal woman, and she handed the biscuit to this child. And as I've told the story, with my three children, I know if they hadn't eaten all day and I gave one of them the biscuit, that one would run quick into a corner, gobble that biscuit down so his brothers didn't see it, you know, and make sure he got his belly full. I know that's what he'd do. This little child, we gave him this biscuit. This kid, how old is he? Four? The first thing he did was break that biscuit in half. And he walked over to the baby and he handed half to the baby, and we wept. This child who has nothing found an apple in his backpack. And if he can do that, just think about what you can do. Thank you very much.